Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of 2023 in session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have received no apologies this morning. Our first agenda item is the consideration of a Type 1 consent notification for the Civil Jurisdiction and Judgments Saving Provisions, Regulations 2023. This is a proposed UK statutory instrument where the UK Government is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to legislate in an area of devolved competence. On the 9th of November 2023, the Minister for Victims and Community Safety notified the committee of the UKSI. The committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government in the manner they have indicated to the Scottish Government. And I therefore welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, Minister for Victims, Community Safety and her supporting officials, Simon Stockwell, Head of Family Law Policy, Scottish Government, Justice Directorate, and Stephanie Smith, Senior Policy Advisor, Courts and Tribunals, also from the Scottish Government's Justice Directorate. Good morning and welcome to you all, and thank you for joining us. I refer members to Papers 1 and invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning and thank you, Convener. As you know, the Scottish Government opposed both Brexit and the retained EU Law Act. However, we recognise that we need to take technical action to ensure that things are able to work as smoothly as possible. In some cases, that involves working with our colleagues at Westminster. The purpose of this statutory instrument at Westminster is to continue the savings made at EU exit to ensure that the 2007 Lugano Convention on Jurisdiction and the recognition and enforcement of judgments in civil and commercial matters can continue to apply in certain legacy cases. The 2007 Lugano Convention contains rules governing jurisdiction in civil and commercial matters when a case has connections to more than one country, as well as rules providing for the recognition and enforcement of judgments in such matters. The Convention is a treaty amongst EU member states, Norway, Iceland and Switzerland, and was entered into by the EU on behalf of member states while the UK was itself a member state. At EU exit, the Convention was revoked for the UK because the UK's membership was dependent on its status as a member state and because its operation relied on reciprocal application, which would no longer occur. However, the Convention was saved for transitional cases, i.e. to save the jurisdiction rules for cases commenced before the end of the transition period and to save the recognition and enforcement rules for judgments issued in cases commenced before then. The savings provision relied in part on Section 4 of the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018, the Withdrawal Act, and Section 2 of the REUL Act will repeal Section 4 of the Withdrawal Act at the end of the year. And this repeal creates a risk that the savings put in place will fall away. So the proposed SI will use transitional powers under the REUL Act in order to continue the savings provision. Since the original savings for transitional cases extended UK-wide, the UK government proposed to extend this SI UK-wide. As I said, Scottish ministers remain opposed to Brexit. However, in terms of minimising the damage that EU exit will bring, this technical SI is necessary to ensure continuity to respect of relevant judgments and issued before the end of the transition period. It will also save the recognition and enforcement rules for judgments issued in cases commenced before the end of the transition period. The relatively small number of REUL Act statutory instruments proposed notified to committees, 7 so far, including this SI, reflects that the government will never consent to proposals that threaten the vital safeguards and high standards Scotland benefited from being part of the European Union. The programme for government commits the government to maintaining alignment where possible and meaningful with EU law, and this SI has devolved implications. The committee is asked to agree to the UK-wide SI being made, and Convener, I invite the committee to agree that the Scottish ministers should consent to this SI being made. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Do members have any questions? Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much. And good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here this morning. Just a quick question around issues that could have arisen after the transition period. Given the commitment to alignment that the Scottish Government has made, what are the measures, are there measures in place that we can take independently of the UK legislature on these cost savings beyond transition, or is that it? Is it, I suppose essentially what I'm asking, is there a way that we can continue to be aligned with the likes of Iceland, Norway and Switzerland beyond the cut-off period?
My understanding is that they will be diminished in time, and I know there's a very limited number at the moment going through, but I might bring in Simon on that question.
Thank you, Minister. I think it might be difficult for Scotland itself to align, because a lot of this depends on international arrangements, which is reserved to the United Kingdom government. Mm-hmm. The UK government is planning to sign and ratify a convention, the Hague 19 Convention, which is about the mutual recognition of civil and commercial judgments. And the United Kingdom has just confirmed that it intends to do that, and right. Scotland will form part of that. Okay. So there will be some moves to try and ensure that we continue to have some recognition with other jurisdictions. But it's hard for Scotland to do it alone, given, as I say, treaty negotiations are a reserved matter for the UK.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful.
You're content? Thank you. I now move on to the substantive question for this item. Is the committee content for the provision set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK statutory instrument? We are all agreed. Thank you. We will write to the Scottish Government to that effect. That concludes the consideration of the UK statutory instrument, and I thank the Minister and her officials for your attendance. We will now suspend very briefly to allow for a changeover of supporting officials for our next agenda item. Thank you. We'll now move into our second agenda item, which is our final evidence session on the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill. And I once again welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, the Minister for Victims, Community Safety and Supporting Officials for this item. I also welcome Jamie Wellham, the Legal Services Regulation Reform Manager, Scottish Government Justice Directorate, and Liana McClarty, Solicitor from the Scottish Government's Legal Directorate. Thank you for joining us this morning, and I refer members to papers 2 and 3, and I ask the Minister, I invite her to make a brief opening statement, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Convener and Committee members. Thank you for the opportunity to appear today to discuss the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill. The Bill presents a modern regulatory framework designed to promote competition and innovation while improving the transparency and the accountability of legal regulation and the legal complaint system in Scotland, placing the public and consumer interest at its heart. The bill is intended to bring benefits to both the legal sector and consumers of legal services. It makes a number of significant changes, including introducing a new regulatory framework, streamlining the legal complaint system, introducing entity regulation and the legal protection of the title lawyer. The bill removes restrictions on third sector organisations directly employing solicitors, benefiting vulnerable citizens and easing ownership requirements for alternative business structures benefiting the legal sector. There is a great deal of support for the general principles of the improvements this bill will make to legal regulations. And as I said in my letter last week to the committee, which outlined the amendments we intend to bring forward, throughout the development of the bill, the Scottish Government has been committed to working collaboratively with all interested parties, including the legal sector and those representing the consumer interest, and we will continue to do so during the bill's passage through Parliament. We know that the parties often have differing views on regulation of legal services, and this is why we want to ensure it strikes the right balance between the various interests. Following introduction of the bill and having carefully considered the responses to the committee's call on views, which was published on the 24th of August, we acknowledge that the concerns raised in respect of the role placed on Scottish ministers within the bill. Whilst these relevant provisions are only part of the bill, we wanted to address those concerns and so publicly stated we would bring forward amendments at stage two and would work with stakeholders, including the senior judiciary. As members will be aware, having taken evidence from stakeholders, the current legislative framework underpinning the regulation of legal services and the complaints handling process in Scotland is complex and it's dated. Not unexpectedly, this is a highly technical and complex bill, amending previous legislation from 1980, 2007 and 2010, and it builds on some of those existing legislative provisions, which is why it is vitally important that any amendments are carefully considered and discussed with all the stakeholders. My officials have been working closely and collaboratively with stakeholders, particularly the Lord President's Office and the Law Society of Scotland. And as I said in my letter, we've already come to a firm position on several areas of the bill to amend and close to agreement on other areas, and we will be updating the committee on those in the new year on the areas that are being addressed. I appreciate that the committee has requested sight of those amendments. However, whilst we're in a position on most of the amendments, or as I said, into close agreement, the actual amendments would not be written until closer to the stage two, and again will be developed alongside discussion with the Lord President's office and stakeholders. Convener, I also recognise the importance of stage one parliamentary process in drawing out stakeholder views as well as that of the committee, and those views will also inform final positioning and amendments. Convener, let me conclude by saying that whilst I intend to bring forward amendments to address the specific concerns raised, I would like to highlight that in my view, these will not detract away from the general principles of the bill. Roddy Dunlop KC said to the committee on the 21st of November, "The bill seems to strike the right balance between ensuring and improving the proper regulation of the legal profession on one hand and maintaining the profession's independence on the other." Many of the provisions in the bill have been welcomed and are designed to benefit both legal professions and consumers of legal services, and that is what I'd hope we would all want to see. Thank you, Convener. I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And we will just go on to questions. I'll just kick us off. You will have seen the evidence that we have taken from a wide range of stakeholders, including the senators that were here last week. And I would like a response from you, Minister, from about the issues that were raised by witnesses regarding the powers which the bill gives the Scottish ministers, and that may threaten the independence of the legal profession and the judiciary. For instance, I'm sure you will have seen that Lady Dorian was extensively quoted as saying that she felt that the provisions were constitutionally inept. So I just wondered what your response to that was.
Yes, thank you, Convener. The judiciary is raising important constitutional principles about the separation of powers between the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. And, of course, we recognise the absolute necessity of that principle. it is important to be clear of what the bill actually does. It does not impinge on the independence of the legal profession or the judiciary, and I wrote to the committee on the 29th of November to make my intentions clear and how I will amend the bill to address these issues. The bill builds on existing legislative framework, which provides a role for ministers to act in the public interest to ensure that regulation is being carried out effectively and transparently. The provisions adopt existing checks and balances requiring the Lord President's consent and parliamentary scrutiny of the use of the delegated powers to ensure any action is in the interests of legal practitioners and the public. Ministers have had a role in legal regulation in Scotland since 1990. In 2007 and in 2010, this Parliament placed further functions on Scottish ministers in respect of the legal services regulation. In saying that, we understand the concerns which have been raised, and that is why we've committed to bring forward amendments at stage two, as we want to ensure the bill strikes the right balance between the various stakeholders.
Okay. So I understand what you're saying about the removal of the role of the Scottish ministers, which you said that you would do, and we've heard evidence on that, on position of England and Scotland with their distinct differences. And as I understand, the Legal Services Board in England is accountable to the Lord Chancellor to the UK, Government Secretary of State of Justice. So that is a political role as well. Can you confirm that that won't be replicated in Scotland?
Yes, so the Legal Services Board is accountable to Parliament through the Lord Chancellor, who's a UK minister, who has a number of statutory roles in relation to a body and regulation of legal services. Our bill does contain some of the provisions which introduce a role for Scottish ministers in reviewing and protecting the regulation of legal services. But as the committee is aware, we will be introducing amendments which will transfer those functions to the Lord President, removing the responsibility from Scottish ministers.
So while some reassurance was taken by your intention regarding the amendments to remove that role, there were concerns that were raised that it wasn't going to be as easy as that, that the removal of that bit of it would actually affect quite extensively the other parts of the bill. Can you provide the committee with any reassurance around that?
Yes, absolutely. I think this is where we are having my officials have been having ongoing discussions with the Lord President's office, and any amendments that come in, that they will have an ongoing effect on other parts of the bill, and that's why we have to engage on all aspects of it moving forward with the amendments. So it's not a straight cut, it's just removing one and giving it to the Lord President. We have to consider the whole bill while we're doing these amendments.
Thank you, Minister. And you referred yourself that you wrote a letter to me with the aim of finalising the amendments early next year. So I'm just, I just need a little bit more detail there and a bit more reassurance, because obviously we're in December now. Yeah. That's not that far away. The task you have ahead of you and your officials is obviously, it's extensive. So what does the government have a more specific deadline?
At the moment, we officials are working with all stakeholders and the Law Society of Scotland and Lord President's office, and engagement is continuing. We are hopeful that it will be the beginning of the new year that we have agreement on most of the amendments. And what I'm willing to do is keep the committee updated on all progress regarding that.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I'd like to now... was there anybody, colleagues, that wanted to come in? No, we're all right. I'd like to pass on to Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener. I'm just trying to understand why we're in this position, where we're having to amend at stage two. This committee doesn't have detail of that, nor does the Lord President or the Senators of the College of Justice. I mean, the Minister would accept it as highly unusual for the most senior judges in the country to come to a committee of the Scottish Parliament and give evidence. So can she just outline for me very clearly what consultation took place with the Lord President and what information he was given about the nature of these amendments?
Sure. First of all, I think when the bill was introduced back in April, and then obviously we had the call for views in August, I was very conscious of the bill. It was all about the Scottish ministers having a power grab as such, and that's why I wanted to detract away the Scottish ministers powers, and this is why the officials have been looking at bringing in amendments, so it wouldn't focus so much on that, and it would focus on parts of the bill that there was agreement on generally through stakeholders and the legal profession. Just going back to the Scottish Government response to the consultation analysis published in December last year, we did set out that to provide for the process for intervention by Scottish ministers in the light of the concerns being raised on how and whether regulators are delivering their regulatory objectives and the operation of regulation in relation to the public interest. At the time when that consultation came out last year, the legal stakeholders were very positive because I think the focus was about the independent regulator being brought forward, and it wasn't. So at that stage when we brought that forward, there wasn't any resistance to the Scottish Minister's role in that. That only came after the bill was laid prior to April and with the introduction of that. If I could just go on and just explain a little bit about the amendments. Because of the complexity of the amendments and having to engage with all the stakeholders, we need to get agreement with the Lord President and the Law Society and all our stakeholders. And we would not be in a position, once we have agreement, we would not be in a position to actually get the lawyers to draft the actual amendments to stage two. So that's the ongoing work that's happening with officials at the moment, with stakeholders and with the Lord President's office.
Sorry, Convener, I am confused just in terms of the evidence that we heard last week. I mean, Lady Dorian, when asked directly about what engagement had been had over these amendments, said that high-level suggestions had been made to us. She spoke about being presented with a paper that the senators felt they couldn't respond to because it was lacking in detail. She said there was another paper with more detail, but it was very high-level. They have not looked at detailed proposals for amendment and have said that in so far as they were able to do so, they have responded as helpfully as they could. But she crucially says that the devil's in the detail and you can't comment on what you don't have in terms of the detail. So again, I'm trying to understand why we are in this position.
Yeah, I'm happy to address it. I might get my officials who have been liaising with the Lord President's office, but I agree, the devil is in the detail. But the discussions with the Lord President's office and other stakeholders are in agreement what the detail will be as when we go forward to the stage two amendments. I don't know if Leanna or Jamie would want to come in there with about engagement with the Lord President's office.
Certainly. Thank you. As we said, we have shared two papers with the Lord President's office, and since that the last evidence session, we have shared a third paper in response to their request for some work examples in terms of how the amendments would operate in practice. They have asked for the amendments to be able to comment on those, but it's a bit of a chicken and the egg in that we have to agree the position before we can then draft amendments and seek that agreement. So it is an iterative process, and progress is being made. And as Minister said, we are close to an agreed position, and we are having a constructive engagement.
Have you got time? Or?
I think you do, yes. And then I believe Megan would like to come in. Yeah.
Yeah, I appreciate the degree to which we want to try and find consensus, and the Lord President is obviously keen to, and other stakeholders, to have a contribution to this amendment. But would the Minister accept that it is for this committee to make a judgment on these amendments? And any changed nature of the bill will have to once again be scrutinised. Yep. And that is a real challenge in terms of timescales for this committee to carry out its democratic function.
Yes, I do recognise that, and that's why I'll be very eager and keen to share, as my letter said from last week, where we are with each of the sections that are going to be amended. As we have progress and agreement with our stakeholders and the Lord President, I'm happy to keep the committee updated on all progress on that so you can make a view on it for your stage one.
Thank you. Megan, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just on the back of the discussions that we're having so far, I'm struggling to understand. It seems to be like a chicken and egg situation, because we've got the situation where we're looking at amendments that are going to substantially change. We've had to take evidence on a bill that will substantially change. So I do need to ask the question, Minister, why do you think it was appropriate for ministers to be directly appointed as a legal regulator, and why hasn't more engagement regarding the amendments taken place? Because as Paula Kane rightly said, you know, the devil's in the detail, but we as the committee do not know that detail. It looks as though senior professionals in the legal field do not know that detail. If you had concerns back in August, in terms of when the call for views came in, you were getting evidence, why didn't that engagement start then? I just feel as though that we're sort of clambering around just now, trying to look for a way to scrutinise this legislation. When we come back at the turn of the year, we're going to have to relook at that all over again.
Mm-hmm. I think engagement, when we did make the decision back in August, the officials did start to engage with stakeholders in the Lord President's office about what the sections that were highlighted on where we can make amendments and come to an agreement with it. I appreciate what Ms Gallagher's saying there, but I felt at the time that when it was introduced, there was such opposition to ministers' powers in the bill, and even Esther Robertson in the DPLR committee evidence, she didn't believe that ministers should have a role, that I didn't want it detracting away from the general principles of the bill, which in a way it has done. So the general framework and the renewing the Scottish legal complaint system and make it easier for consumers, that's all good parts of the bill that we can move forward and focus on. But I was just trying to take away the Scottish ministerial, and as I've said, what we will do is we will keep the committee updated on all progress in relation to that as soon as we can.
Okay, thank you. I think we will move on just now to Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and officials. I would like to ask you if you think there are any risks in giving the Lord President additional powers in the amendments. For example, the proposal to amend Section 29 would give the Lord President the sole right to consider any application by bodies wishing to enter the legal services sector as a new regulator. Do you think that there's a risk that the Lord President might be either too conservative or too slow in deciding which bodies could become new regulators?
So, yes, I saw the evidence from Bill Alexander saying that it was challenging and sometimes traumatic for the commercial attorneys to become a regulator at that time. And I think from 1980, they're the only people that have become a regulator. And then I did see that Lady Dorian did say it should be challenging going through the process. So I think we do strike a balance there between people going forward to be regulated. So, yes, I do believe that it does strike a balance.
Thank you. And if I may come back in, Convener, do you think that the proposed transfer of these certain functions to the Lord President alter the general principles of the bill?
I do not believe they do. I think, as the committee has heard in the evidence session last week, the Lord President already has significant oversight role into legal services regulation. So this is not the same as directly regulating the provision of legal services. The Lord President's not involved into the day-to-day regulation of legal services, but he does have oversight of the aspects of the SLCC, but does not consider determining complaints. So I do not believe the overview of the bill, no.
And can I ask, the judiciary have raised concerns that transferring functions to the Lord President risks politicising his role, and others have said that transferring functions mean consumer groups might not have enough say. Can I ask what your position is on that?
Yes. Thank you to Ms Adams for the question. In transferring the functions to the Lord President, we will be expanding the current oversight role in legal services regulation. This does not create a new function for the Lord President, but expands a role which already exists and operates without concerns of politicisation. Whilst the senators indicated to the committee that they cannot agree to any transfer before seeing the detail, it may be helpful to remind the committee of their written response, which showed that the principle of transferring the review powers to the Lord President was acceptable and indeed should be done. In respect to the consumer voice, the bill expands the remit of the consumer panel, giving a role to undertake research to provide quality evidence-based advice in the sector in order to ensure decisions are shaped around the needs of the different consumers of legal services, including individuals, businesses and the third sector. The consumer voice is essential in legal services regulation, and we're reflecting on the comments of stakeholders representing the consumer interest in terms of how the bill might be strengthened in that regard.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Minister. Thank you.
Content. OK. Megan, please.
Again, Convener. Minister, we heard from Esther Robertson last week in relation to the report that was commissioned. So I'm a little bit confused. Why did the government reject Esther Robertson report that recommended a single legal regulator in Scotland, despite your own government commissioning the very same report?
Yes, thank you. I think as the committee's already heard, there was vastly differing views for Esther Robertson's primary recommendation. And this was backed up by a consultation which showed that views were evenly split between support and opposition to the primary recommendation. However, there are many areas where there is broad agreement between the stakeholders. The bill takes a proportionate approach that seeks to balance and deliver the key priorities of the stakeholders. And the bill requires that all legal service regulators exercise regulatory functions independently of other functions or activities, and introduces greater transparency and accountability of the legal services regulation. But in a whole, it was just due to both sides, being the legal profession and the consumers, having very polarised views on the independent regulator, that the decision was made not to go down that track.
OK, thank you. But that doesn't really equate to the evidence that we've heard in the committee session so far. So I'm just wondering, Minister, do you think it's fair to say that as the legislation, as it stands, because we've not seen the amendments thus far, that you have managed to upset all sides of the debate surrounding the legal regulation in Scotland?
So I don't think it's trying to find the compromise in the middle. I don't think it's like trying to upset both sides. I think, you know, the Scottish Government has carefully considered the Robertson report following its publication, had an extensive discussion with stakeholders. While it's clear, as I said, the recommendations that were supported, there were very polarised views from the legal sector as well. So I think with the bill, we have heard from stakeholders that there's a lot of support for the bill. For example, Dr. Marcia Scott from Scottish Women Aid, she said, "I welcome many aspects of the bill and the removal of practising restrictions on charities directly employing a solicitor are very welcome." And that will be transformational for charities to be able to support vulnerable people. So there's a lot of positive things in the bill as well. So it's not, I wouldn't say I'm not making both sides happy.
I think the key phrase there was many aspects. And then finally, if I can, Convener, in relation to the Robertson report that sets out the extremely complex landscape of Scotland's legal services regulation, that can be often difficult for the public to understand. So I'm just wondering, as the bill stands, you know, why is this legislation made it even more complicated for members of the public to understand?
So I think that the basically, the, one of the main things with the complaints is to make it, to simplify the process for the general public. And the SLCC will remain the single gateway for all legal complaints against legal practitioners, with a limited number of exceptions, for example, where a complaint is identified as a regulator. The consultation that we did, that most respondents, 87%, agreed that the single gateway for all legal complaints should be retained, and it was argued that a single gateway for all legal complaints is efficient to bring clarity and transparency to the process, both the profession and the consumers, making it simpler for the consumers to access legal advice.
Thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you. Thank you, Megan. I'd like to now move to my colleague Fulton, please.
Hey, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and the panel. I've got a few questions, Minister. I think you'll probably acknowledge from having watched the evidence that I think it's fair to say that no stakeholder that we've heard from supports the full package of reforms within this bill. Although many have said, you know, and I had to go back through some of the evidence myself, but because I think you've made the point that perhaps some aspects of the bill can be lost, and many stakeholders have told us that they support certain aspects of the bill that's perhaps relevant to them. How much of an issue do you think, in your role, this is, that there's not outright full support from the groups that we've heard from? Where are you on that?
I think where we go back to 2015, where the Law Society did approach the Scottish Government for the need of reform, and that's when I know historically the Esther Robertson report asked to do an inquiry into it to produce a report. And I think after the report was published, we then saw the polarised views from the legal sector and the commercial sector. So I do not believe that there would be any way that this bill could move forward, getting both sides on board 100%, because there's always going to be a conflict between the legal sector and consumer. And it's trying to find that fine balance between the two, that we can bring good legislation in to improve things for the legal sector and for consumers.
Do you run the risk, though, by by trying to strike that balance, which I hear that is what you're trying to do, and I think that is what the government have tried to do, that we end up with a bill that nobody's very happy with?
Well, I think we have to strike the balance. I think if we end up with no bill, then we'll have no improvement to legal reform, which is required and needed from the legal sector and the consumer. So I think the positive aspects of the bill will still bring forward progress to reform of the legal sector, even though there may be some opposed views going along the way.
Okay, thanks for that. And on the issue of consumers, I'd like to hear from you where you think there might be more benefits. And I want to ask about a specific example that other MSPs in the office will likely be aware from the constituency work, but also an event that was held by my colleague Bob Doris last week, relating to McClure's solicitors when they went bust in 2021. I hadn't thought about it previously before the event that Bob held last week, and I've had a couple of queries from constituents myself. Do you think that there's anything in this bill that would help, or perhaps would have helped, in that particular situation and others like it?
Yes, and I do. I think the McClure situation shows a necessity for justice reform in addressing that situations like the McClure situation doesn't happen again. I'm aware of all the number of families that are facing a result of McClure's going into administration. I know as MSPs we've all been contacted by constituents. I can't comment on individual cases, but the Scottish Government has taken proactive steps to help mitigate against such a situation. Such cases show that the need for legal regulation that centres of the public interest and protection of the consumer. And this bill is currently going through Parliament, will introduce the authorisation of legal businesses, and this will bring benefits such as consistency in how legal firms are regulated, with all entities having to meet the same high standards and a greater collation of data, which would enable the regulator and the legal profession to identify and address deficiencies early and take the necessary preventative action. And if I may, convener, I know this is not the same bill, but with my trust and succession bill, which is currently going through as well, we've just had stage two, I heard of the significant practical difficulties that co-trustees may have had in administering trusts when a trustee appointment in their professional capacity is no longer a member of the profession, and that's why I lodged amendments at stage two of the Trust and Succession Scotland Bill to ensure that this wouldn't happen moving forward. So with the bills that are going through with justice reform, we can address situations like McClure's that can prevent that happening in the future.
Okay, thanks for that, Minister. And could I ask as well if you're able to respond to arguments that we heard from the Law Society as well as others, that the case has not been made for splitting regulators in Category 1 and Category 2, which are subject to different requirements.
Yes,
is that okay to just move on?
Yep,
to the different,
that's fine. So the Law Society has 12,000 members, and one-third of those work in-house, and the other two-thirds predominantly serve the public and handle client money. On the other hand, there are 450 advocates in Scotland, and advocates are members of an independent referral bar. That means, as a general rule, the advocates do not provide their services directly to the public, but are available to be instructed by solicitors and other designated professionals and bodies. And similarly, there are 10 practicing members of the Association of Construction Attorneys, and construction attorneys operate in a specialist area of law. It was viewed proportionate response to put greater regulatory requirements on the body, which with substantially more members, being 12,000, as opposed to the construction attorneys who have 10. And I think in the evidence session with yourselves, they did say they would have struggled to be a category one, the attorneys. So the bill significantly increases the transparency of all three branches of the legal profession and future-proofs the framework to provide a risk-based and proportionate approach to any new entrant into the Scottish legal sector.
Thanks. One final question.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, convener. Very, very generous. We heard that there was some argument that the system of regulation and complaints handling that's proposed in the bill is too complex. What would you say to that, Minister? Do you believe it's too complex, or have you got another view?
Yes. So, no, I do not believe it's too complex. I believe that we are improving the system. Regulatory complaints already exist in respect of licensed legal services providers, and the bill will extend this type of complaint to authorised legal businesses in respect of the introduction of entity regulation. I do not believe it's making it more complex. I believe it's simplifying the system for consumers to access legal advice.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Minister. I'd like to move on to Annie, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and officials. I'd like to just ask you to explain why the Scottish Government considers it necessary for solicitors and other regulated professionals to have at least a 10% stake in alternative business structures.
Can I thank Ms. Wells for her answer? So, question. Certain stakeholders, such as the CMA, support a removal of a minimum ownership requirement entirely, while there were other stakeholders, including some legal firms, which favoured retaining the current 51% ownership by regulated professionals. So there was a divergence of views in the response to the Scottish Government consultation, and just over half, which was 52%, agreed at that 51% majority stake rule for licensed legal services should be removed, compared to 48% that disagreed. So some stakeholders have actually shifted their view on this slightly since the Scottish Government consultation, but the approach we are seeking in the bill, we think it strikes a balance between the two views.
So how did you come up with the 10%? How does that...
Okay. I might bring in my officials. Yeah. I've got the history there.
Of course, certainly it was considered that a 10% would retain a minimum requirement of the regulated profession to have a stake in that business, and it aligns with what the Minister has set out in terms of striking the right balance there. So 10% was felt an appropriate minimum percentage if you required to retain a regulated investment.
Thanks for that. And I've just got one more question, if you don't mind, Convener. In response to the views that there could be unintended consequences by regulating the title lawyer, we've had various different views on this, and I would like to hear your views, Minister, please.
Sure, thank you. I think so the public polling by the government and the Law Society has shown support for the title lawyer being given under the same protection as solicitor. And this was considered important to protect the consumer, who may not understand the distinction between the two when seeking legal services from a regulated professional. I know that the committee also heard anecdotal evidence of solicitors being struck off and subsequently providing unregulated legal services to the public using the title of lawyer. So we view that there is public protection concern in such cases to protect the name lawyer.
Okay. Thanks for that, Convener. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Thanks, Annie. Maggie, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for your comments so far, Minister. I've got a couple of questions on the SLCC, the new body that the bill proposes to establish, and something around the processes involved. Firstly, the SLCC considers that the responsibility for dealing with complaints remains split between bodies, and that professional bodies may have a conflict of interest. That's what the bill outlines. How do you respond to that challenge around that split and the conflict of interest point?
Yes, so I might bring in, if I can, Jamie, just to answer this question.
Of course. The bill will require regulators to carry out their functions in terms of regulation separately from any other function, such as handling of complaints. In response to the consultation exercise, around about two-thirds of respondents supported the existing bodies, such as the Law Society and the Faculty, having a continued role in the handling of complaints about conduct. And it was viewed that that would be important in terms of quality assurance and continuous improvement, and that it feeds back into better practice if the bodies involved in setting the rules are also the ones who have a role in handling those complaints.
Okay, I suppose there's just something around the complexity that split maybe retains, and one of the challenges as Fulton and others have already alluded to. But I'll come back to that in a moment. There's something also around the SLCC's assertion that it requires additional powers. Additional powers both around ensuring it gets information in a timely way and also around things like setting minimum standards. But they've been questions around whether there are sufficient checks and balances to ensure that the SLCC don't abuse those additional powers. Can you comment around, you know, what do you think there are sufficient checks and balances, or is there something else we should be looking at?
I do know that I recognise a significant problem for the SLCC regarding, I think it's over 300 solicitors a year, do not respond to the request for files as such, and we are working with them at the moment and looking at amendments and how we can strengthen the bill moving forward so they get the information that they need. I don't know, Leanne, if you wanted to come in.
In terms of the overall checks and balances for the Commission, mm-hmm. So the Commission is accountable to Parliament in terms of its budget and its annual report, and in terms of its ability to make or change its rules, it has to consult with a number of bodies, including the Lord President and the regulators and other bodies when it's making its rules. The Lord President also has oversight of the Commission board members in the respect that the Lord President can remove the chair of the board if it was felt that that person was unfit to in carrying out their duties, and his approval is sought where the chair seeks to remove any other member of the board. So this is that's the overall accountability of the Commission. In terms of the provisions in the bill to introduce minimum standards, where those minimum standards relate to the regulators, the bill tries to introduce a lot of opportunities for the regulators to be involved in the development of those minimum standards if, once those have been developed, there's still a dispute with the regulator. The bill introduces provisions for that to go to arbitration between the regulator and the Commission if there really is a dispute as to the minimum standard that's being set. If it doesn't go to arbitration, because that's optional, ultimately the court can look at the question of the minimum standards and whether and how to resolve that dispute. So whilst the bill does strengthen the ability for the Commission to introduce standards rather mm-hmm. than just recommendations as it is now, there is a kind of quite firm level of accountability in that to make sure that it can be examined and that there's a role for the regulator in developing those standards.
Okay, so I suppose the question is, if I mean the mechanisms of the checks and balances that you outline, and I understand what they are. They are retrospective in many ways, and I suppose is there certainty or enough certainty that actually that the processes before we get to a point where those need to be invoked. Is there certainty around that the powers that the new Commission would have there, that they wouldn't not abuse those powers, but act in a way that wasn't congruent with the principles of the bill and the powers they've been given?
I mean, certainly the efforts, so the intention, the efforts in drafting has been to make sure that it's as collaborative a process okay. as possible, and that collaboration, you know, the hope would be that any concerns that were being raised about proposed minimum standards would be raised and that the and taken account of, yeah. And that there are measures if they weren't. But of course, we consider any recommendations for strengthening that if it's felt like they're not strong enough.
Okay. Thanks, Diana. I've got another question, but it's on a different issue.
I just indicated to Maggie that I wanted to come in on the complaints issue as well, just to get a bit more information about that. I mean, we heard evidence from the SL, I can never remember initials, and I don't think they're a good thing, they're very exclusive initials, but the SLCC regarding sort of like their powers that they have, and on the one hand they welcome the changes, but they also argued for more powers actually. So I just wondered what consideration was given to maybe giving the SLCC more powers.
I am open to any considerations the committee would like to suggest moving forward at stage one, but I think at the moment we are striking a balance with the powers that the SLCC do have. I don't know if any...
It was particularly regarding, it was a session that we had that they were saying about getting information, for instance, that depending on the complexity of the complaint, sometimes they could ask for information that could come back in 7 days, sometimes it would be 21, sometimes it would be 28. So it was to make that better for the consumer, I suppose, for the mm-hmm. complainant.
And I think one of the things we are working with them at the moment, because I think it was over a quarter of solicitors do not respond when they're requested for their files for information from the SLCC. So we are working with them at the moment to see how we can strengthen the bill to ensure they get the information that they need.
Okay. Leanna, did you want to come in?
Just to expand on what the Minister was saying, I mean, in that respect, I don't think it's necessarily seeking more powers as just a better way. They already have the power to require solicitors and other practitioners to provide information, but the problem, as the Minister said, is that that's not always done. Mm. And that the only recourse that the Commission has is to go to court to seek the information that they have a right to obtain as part of processing a complaint. So we are working with the Commission, as Neil said, I think, at committee, to make it easier for them and to avoid having to go through the court process to try and obtain the information that they have a right to get.
Okay, thank you. On this issue, Megan, did you want to come in? No, that's fine. Oh, I was too much on it there. Thank you for that. Thank you. Can I bring Maggie back in, please?
Super. Thanks. I suppose just another quick follow-up, actually, on some of the complexity issues around the Commission. We know that the questions... There have been questions around from very different stakeholders, very different interests, around the complexity that the consumers face. And Minister, you've talked quite a lot about balance and trying to balance competing views. I'm just wondering whether there's whether you think we've got that balance right around the different processes and procedures that the faculty have to go through, that the Law Society would have to go through, that consumers have to mm-hmm. go through, you know, having to potentially jump through different hoops or go to different bodies to pursue complaints, and just how you came, or you know, how it came to the decision that we find in the bill.
Sure. Yes. Yeah. I do. I think the main aspect of one of the bills is to simplify the process for the consumers, and I will go to Leanna or Jamie to come in on the history with the deeper understanding of the bill before I talk it over.
I might pass to Jamie for that one.
Of course, yes, as we set out, the consultation analysis showed that it was important for the professional bodies to continue to have a role in conduct complaints, but the bill does seek to simplify the current process to make it more streamlined and proportionate in terms of the statutory processes that the SLCC have to go through at the minute to examine a complaint from a consumer, so that there is swifter consideration of their complaint, which benefits the consumer, and also legal professional who has a complaint about them being raised. The bill also allows for the Law Society and the faculty to bypass the single gateway where that's appropriate, so that currently they have to raise a complaint to the SLCC if it's an issue that they have identified. The bill will remove that step so that there's not that ping-pong between those bodies, so that it will go straight to the Law Society to investigate, and they can move more swiftly in terms of investigating that complaint. The bill does seek to make the process for consumers easier to access, and also widens up consumer protection in terms of the unregulated complaints as well, so there's greater protection to consumers.
Thanks, Jamie. That's helpful. And I mean, we heard from the consumer panel of the SLCC that they broadly welcomed the simplification processes and proposals in the bill. That's all my questions on this, but I do have one final sort of general question.
Okay, pause that. I'm going to bring in Megan just now and then bring you back in.
Thanks, Convener. And it is on what Maggie Chapman's been raising about striking the right balance between the consumer and the legal profession. We've heard a lot of striking the right balance this morning, but no real explanation as to how that's measured. And I think that's something that perhaps the Minister needs to explain to committee, but also to the public. But I'm wondering, and it does go back to my question of understanding, if the Minister can summarise the reforms that this bill brings, that's easy for the public to understand, because I'm not sure with the discussions that we've had this morning that we're in that space yet.
Sure. I think it might be easy just to point the committee to the evidence that's been heard across the board welcoming changes to the bill to make the complaint system easier. We had the SLCC's Chief Executive, Neil Stevenson, said the bill takes tremendous steps towards to reduce the complexity and give the Commission extra discretion to deal with particular situations, which should benefit consumers and practitioners. And we had Rosemary Agnew of the SPSO said the bill approaches a quality assurance and continuous improvement is not just best practice, but enables the development of best practice. And Rachel Woods of the Law Society welcomed the changes that the bill brings in with regard to making the system faster and more streamlined and less complex for the consumer. And she also welcomed the ability for the Law Society to raise and begin investigating a complaint directly with the reintroduction of the hybrid complaints, which will speed things up and make it less expensive for the consumer as well.
But going back to striking the right balance, how is that measured?
Bring in Leanna for that.
Well, actually, Jamie.
Of course. Certainly, it was the bill has been framed in response to the consultation analysis in terms of the views of stakeholders. It was felt important that the professional bodies have that role in investigating complaints, because as they set the rules for how their members that complaints can feedback into that, the bill seeks to provide for a greater focus on quality improvement and continuous improvement, and increases the ability for the Commission to set standards based on trends and complaints and best practice. The bill also expands the remit of the consumer panel so that it can make recommendations not just about the complaints process as it just now, but about the whole framework of legal regulation, and it makes the consumer panel a statutory consultee at various stages in the bill as well, in terms of the setting of rules. So the bill does very much seek to insert the consumer voice into the framework.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Maggie, please.
And my last question. We've heard from different witnesses over the course of our evidence gathering that there's some reforms in the bill are long, long, long overdue. And we often focus on the areas of disagreement, as we have done in the last couple of weeks. But just a question, I suppose, because of the areas of high or very, very clear and quite sort of high-profile disagreement, should I say, Minister? Could you say what's your assessment about the possibility that actually we don't get to the point where we can agree the principles of this bill, and who wins and who loses out of that, given that some people have been waiting for 16, 17 years for some of these reforms?
Yes, I thank Ms. Chapman for the question. The committee has heard about the differing views as to who should be responsible for regulation. However, there is broad support from stakeholders for the wide content of the bill. The introduction of entity regulation, reform of the complex complaint system, the reduction in restrictions in respect of alternative business structure, and the ability for bodies such as Scottish Women's Aid to directly employ legal professions to support their clients in court. These are all really significant improvements on the status quo. And if the bill was not supported, I'm afraid I don't think there would be any winners there. The question's not necessarily about an alternative bill as such, but as the committee is aware, there's no approach which is going to completely satisfy all the groups here. So the bill will provide a proportionate approach that seeks to balance and deliver the key priorities for all the stakeholders moving forward.
Thanks for that. And you said earlier, obviously, that it would be at stage two where you would present amendments to deal with some of those key issues of disagreement. And it would be unprecedented, I think, to have those amendments any earlier than that if they weren't part of the initial drafting. And I suppose there's just a general question, which is maybe a little bit cheeky and unfair, but if you had known then what you know now, and you were designing this bill from scratch, would you have done things a little bit differently?
Well, this bill has a huge long history before I came in April. So, I think there's been a lot of work from officials ongoing throughout the many years of this bill. So I think it has evolved, and I think we just have to continue to listen. We know it's polarised in some areas, and that's why I'm very keen to listen to views of all stakeholders. My official, I will work collaboratively with all the stakeholders and the legal profession. And I know it's not ideal not having the devil in the detail of the amendments going into stage two, but as you said, it is unprecedented because they won't be drafted by the lawyers until all agreement is made with the legal profession, the Lord President's office and the stakeholders, and I'm very keen to share all the information as we progress and we get agreement with the committee as soon as we're able to do so.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Minister, for answering that rather cheeky question there as well, because I think we're all well aware that the initial stages of this bill was not on your watch, as it were. So thank you for taking the question regardless. I think we all understand that reform is difficult for any organisation. And as I was sitting here, I was thinking, imagine if there was a bill came forward to reform the Scottish Parliament only after a couple of decades in history and the uproar that that would probably cause amongst members, let alone anyone else. So I think I understand that change is difficult, reform is difficult, especially when we're applying it to a highly, highly regarded legal profession that is there for hundreds and hundreds of years. So we do understand, and I am grateful for the fact that the Minister has taken the time today and written to us, and I will take her up on her offer to communicate with us fully because we wish to make sure that we do our job correctly in making sure that the reforms going forward are robust and proportionate. In the light of that, I will also take you up on your offer in your opening remarks, where you referred to your letter to me, and there were sections in that annex which you said that you were able to go through and offer a little bit more information around, which would be helpful for our scrutiny, Minister. Could you do that, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. So the sections which have been highlighted with ministerial powers, the first one is Section 5, which allows the regulatory objectives and professional principles to be amended to update to reflect the regulatory best practice. It was included to the bill in response to calls from stakeholders for a permissive and enabling framework of primary legislation that would be flexible enough to respond to future changes in the legal services market by allowing future amendments through secondary legislation. The Scottish Government will, however, accept the recommendation from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that the bill be amended to remove Section 5 and will bring forward an amendment to that effect in Stage 2. The next section is Section 8.
and the creation of a category system for regulators create an inherent requirement for flexibility to respond to any changes or proposed changes to how a regulator operates or in its membership number or its intended to future-proof the regulatory framework. The Scottish Government does acknowledge that the DPLR committee has recommended that the bill be amended to remove Section 8 from the bill. Sections 8, 5, B, C and D are necessary to ensure that the bill accurately reflects any changes to the regulatory framework in respect of a new accredited regulators receiving approval, any regulators ceasing to operate or a change in a regulator's name as recently evidenced in the Association of Construction Attorneys names change.
Sorry to interrupt you there. I've actually, that is sort of referring to the documentation that we have in front of us.
Yes.
So just in the interest of time, that letter has been published. That is available to the public. So it was just to give you the opportunity if there was anything further.
I could go into all the different sections in further detail, but it is outlined in the letter to the committee.
Okay, that's fine. I'm content with that. I just wondered, with regards to this section here as well, that I believe that our deadline that we have for stage one consideration is the 23rd of February. So I think the committee would be interested to know where do you think you will be regarding the amendments by the 23rd of February?
We're hoping to have the amendments agreed by the new year, and that's when I will share that with the committee. We hope for agreement within the new year.
Brilliant. Just checking, just pushing that as far as I can to get that commitment. And just finally, just a yes or no answer would be absolutely fine. And it was to build on Maggie's point of absolute clarity about getting sight of amendments ahead of stage two, that that actually is not, that just doesn't happen, that is not
It would
possible.
Be something because a lawyer, my understanding is the lawyers will draft it at stage two, but we will have agreement to the way forward through the different sections with stakeholders and the Lord President's office that we will be able to provide detail to the committee about, probably not the the exact wording, but where there's a agreed principles for the amendments.
Well, we'd be very grateful for an indication of the intent, which I believe that, you know, we're entitled to have that. But that's great. Thank you very much, Minister. That brings us to the end of our business this morning. And I thank yourself and your officials for attending this morning. We will now move into private session to consider the remaining items on our agenda. Thank you.